in the media conference with Lal Goyal, which is brought to you by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, Malnadu TV, News Gaon se, Samvad Sarokar News, Organ Donation India Foundation and Gyan. Our endeavor is to bring to you every day a new topic, and today is a very, very happy moment for all of us, and that is we all are celebrating our 72nd Republic Day. Before we will start the program, I would like to take you because I just unfurled the national flag a few minutes before this program at Pandit Health Resort and Spa Murbidri. Today's topic is role of youth in Republic India. We, the people of India, having solemnly received to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, social, economic, and political liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. In our Constituent Assembly, this 26th day of November 1949, do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this Constitution. And this is the preamble of our Constitution. India is celebrating its 72nd Republic Day this year. A republic is a form of government in which power is held by the people and their elected representatives. In republics, the country is considered a public matter, not the private concern or property of the rulers. The word republic comes from the Latin term res publica, which literally means public thing, public matter, or public affairs, and was used to refer to the state as a whole. Republic Day is celebrated every year in India on January 26th to commemorate the date on which the Constitution of India came into effect in the year 1950 and the country became a republic. Republic Day, on which the Constitution of India came into effect, replacing the Government of India Act 1935 as the governing document of India, and thus turning the nation into a newly formed republic. The Constitution was adopted by the Indian Constituent Assembly on 26 November 1949 and came into effect on 26 January 1950 with a democratic government system, completing the country's transition towards becoming an independent republic. 26 January was chosen as the date for Republic Day because it was on this day in 1930 when the Declaration of Indian Independence, Purn Swaraj, was proclaimed by the Indian National Congress as opposed to the dominant status offered by the British regime. India achieved independence from British Raj on 15th August 1947, following the Indian independence movement. The independence came through the Indian Independence Act 1947, an act of the Parliament of the United Kingdom. India obtained its independence on 15th August 1947 as a constitutional monarchy with George VI as head of the state and the Earl Mountbatten as Governor General. The country, though, did not yet have a permanent constitution. Instead, its laws were based on the modified Colonial Government of India Act 1935. On 29th August 1947, a resolution was moved for the appointment of drafting committee, which was appointed to draft a permanent constitution with Dr. B.R. Ambedkar as chairman. While India's Independence Day celebrates its freedom from British rule, the Republic Day celebrates the coming into force of its constitution. A draft constitution was prepared by the committee and submitted to the Constituent Assembly on 4th November 1947. The assembly met in sessions open to public for 166 days, spread over a period of 2 years, 11 months and 18 days before adopting the constitution. After many deliberations and some modifications, the 308 members of the assembly signed two handwritten copies of the document, one each in Hindi and English, on 24th January 1950. 2 days later, which was on 26th January 1950, it came into effect throughout the whole nation. On that day, Dr. Rajen Prasad began his first term of office as President of the Indian Union. The Constituent Assembly became the Parliament of India under the transitional provisions of the new constitution. The main Republic Day celebration is held in the national capital, New Delhi, at the Rajpath before the President of India. On this day, ceremonies parade take place at the Rajpath, which are performed as a tribute to India, its unity in diversity and rich cultural heritage. The constitution adopted in 1950 made India a democratic country, and this democracy has been sustained since then. India's sustained democratic freedoms are unique among the world's independent states. The youths play a vital role in the constructive process of building social cohesion, economic prosperity, and political stability in a nation in an inclusive and democratic way. Media Conference with Lal Goyal wishes you all on this auspicious occasion of 72nd Republic Day of India. Now, the topic is role of youth in Republic India. And we have a chief guest. He is Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, IAS. Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, IAS, we welcome you on our show. Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, IAS, is one-man expert commission on labor to prepare an action plan for the welfare and development of the workforce in the context of COVID-19. He was former head of Disaster Management Government of India and Central Draft Relief Commissioner Government of India. He is also the principal advisor Government of India Heritage Project. He was the Vice Chancellor of National Museum, University of Delhi. He has authored 40 books in English, Malayalam, and Hindi, including novels, short stories, and essays. 4 of his books have become bestsellers. 4 books on Vastu and Architecture and 1 book on housing received prestigious the Sharjah International Book Fair Award. Dr. Bose is an housing expert, innovator, writer, orator, and visionary. The path-breaking institutions set up by him, such as Nimriti Kendra Building Center, District Tourism Council, and Habitat Alliance, have been replicated at the state, national, and global level. He was the head of the prestigious Supreme Court Committee on the Treasures of Sri Padmanabha Swami Temple. Dr. Bose addressed United Nations General Assembly and specialized sessions 5 times on various international issues. Dr. Bose is a recipient of 31 national and international awards, including United Nations Global Best Practice Award. He also received prestigious Jawaharlal Nehru Fellowship. Kerala government termed him Lord of Ideas. Former Prime Minister Mr. Manmohan Singh called him inspired civil servant, and our Honorable Prime Minister Mr. Modi called him Man of Ideas. Welcome Dr. C.V. Anand Bose on our show. Dr. Bose, first of all, happy Republic Day to you. And now, as you know, today the country is going to be, or rather is, belongs to the youth. the present and the future. So it's a very important that youth should understand what is their role. So today, as the topic is role of youth in Republic India, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, please.
Thank you, Mr. Goyal. A very warm Republic Day greetings to all our dear viewers, and particularly to the young panelists who are present here. When India is celebrating its 72nd Republic Day, there is a pertinent question which the 17-year-old junior citizens are asking the 70-year-old senior citizens. Have you made this republic a better place for us to live in? A very vexing question, difficult to answer. In the heydays of the French Revolution, the poets said, "Bliss was it to be alive in those days, but to be young was very heaven." This equally applies to the Indian Republic as well. But to be young was very heaven. Youth are the creators of our future. Youth are not creatures of the past or custodians of the present. Youth are the creators of the future. India's destiny lies in the buoyancy of our youth. And we have with us a rich array of young men and women who are second to none in the world. We trust the youth to take this country forward. We trust the youth to make the Republic of India lead the world of future. Who has been responsible for making India what it is today? Where does India stand from the days which it had endured before independence? And where are we now? We are now speaking on the occasion of the pandemic, which has been dealt with very effectively and strongly by the people of India. Where is India today? India can take pride in the fact that we are the largest democracy in the world. Those countries which gained independence along with India, some of them have gone under the military rule and some are under regimented regimes. But India has been able to retain its democracy through successful general elections. India has proved to the whole world that we understand the spirit of democracy, we imbibe it, we implement it. India has been able to put in practice universal adult franchise. Yes, India is the largest democracy in the world. We give priority to the ballot, not the bayonet. That is the greatest achievement of India, in my personal opinion. And secondly, where was India during the British days? We have the distressing memories of the Bengal famine. And then we came after independence. There was a time when we spoke about a ship-to-mouth existence. That is when the PL-480 was in operation. India had to depend on the wheat and rice, which is given by foreign countries to feed its people. Today, India has a surplus of food grains. Do you know that India is the largest producer of milk in the world? India is also the largest producer of cotton, horticultural products, and a variety of pulses, yes. And India is the second largest producer of paddy and wheat. Our farmers have proven to the world, if India did not starve during pandemic, who is responsible for this? The farmers of India. The farmers of India produced enough. India's granaries, our buffer stock is overflowing. That is a place where India has today. And whenever we had a problem of food, we ushered in the green revolution. And now India is speaking about the evergreen revolution. Come to the health sector. When India became independent, the average age life expectancy was 37 years. Now, 10 years back, we crossed 65. Infant mortality is less than half of what it was when we became the republic. India has many firsts to its credit in science and technology. India has used science and technology effectively in areas as vastly different as atomic energy and agriculture. Do you know that in 1956, the first ever nuclear reactor was set up, Apsara in Trombay, by Homi Bhabha, the first nuclear reactor in Asia. We today have 23 nuclear reactors. We have the Chandrayaan, we have the Mangalyaan. We have used the science and technology to the hilt and proven to the world, India is second to none. And in the area of infrastructure, do you know that Indira Gandhi International Airport is the world's best airport in the world, not only in the handling number of passengers, but also in other services. Indian Railways is one of the largest network of rail networks in the world, serving 23 million people a day. Indian Post, with 1,56,000 post offices, is the largest in the world. And look at our youngsters. We have Sachin Tendulkar. He has the highest run in international cricket. And we have Abhinav Bindra, who bagged the gold medal in Olympics. This is not to forget Sania Mirza and Baby Sindhu. They're all youngsters in the field of sports and games who brought laurels to themselves and glory to this country. This country is progressing. We have our enemies, yes, from within and without. We have the Break India Brigade within, but India is able to defend itself. Do you know that India has the third largest army in the world? Yes, 13 million are there. India is ready. India is ready for anything. And now, in India, we have the right to education as a fundamental right. Many countries do not have this. Right to Information Act has been passed. You know, the midday meal scheme, which serves more than 12 crores of children, is the largest, biggest such scheme in the whole world. India has come of age. If India has come of age, who is responsible for this? Yes, every proud citizen of India, you and me, are responsible for this. But there are two triggers which I would bring to your kind attention. The two triggers for India's health, development, and prosperity. And those two triggers are, number one, the mothers of India. Number two, the youth of India. If India has reached the top of the world in many fields, if Indian professionals, doctors, engineers, nurses, IT professionals are respected the world over, who is responsible for this? It is because the semi-literate, illiterate mothers, particularly in the rural areas, Indian mothers raised their children well. That is why India is on top of the world. Three salutes to our mothers, three cheers to the Indian motherhood. Even during pandemic, if India did not break down, who is responsible? The mothers. It is said that during pandemic, even now, India is ruled by the kitchen cabinet. The mothers of India. Three cheers to the mothers of India. And now coming to the youth. Yes, the youth have been responsible for the growth and the prosperity of India. Indian youth are second to none. You give them the order, go. They are there to reach any impregnable fortresses where knowledge, hard work, perseverance, and smartness are required. Indian children are second to none. India leads the world. Do you know that the average age in India is 29, whereas the average age in the United States is 40. In Europe, it is 46. In Japan, it is 47. India is going to be the largest young nation by 2030. We have the bubbling young blood with us. This young generation will certainly take India to the top of the world. There is no doubt about that. I have only one request to make to the younger generation who are assembled here, particularly the opinion makers, the young panelists here. Now, there is a pernicious tendency among society to send the mothers, when they are old, to the old age homes, or also to some of the spiritually important havens like Vrindavan, abandoning the mother when they are old. This is a tendency which has come because of the sedulous aping of the West. No, we owe it to the mothers. We owe it to them to look after them with the tender care when they are old. My request to the panelists and through them to the youngsters is, please take a Republic Day pledge today that I will take care of my old mother. I will protect her. That is something which we owe to the mothers of India, youth and motherhood. I think these are the two major factors which will see that the nation goes forward. And the 70-year-olds or the older senior citizens like me, I have a suggestion to make. Are we able to take a Republic Day pledge that we will surrender political power to the youngsters? We would like to have youngsters rule us. Yes, once again I repeat, blessed was it to be young in those, but to be young was in heaven. Blessed was it to be in alive in those days, but to be young was very heaven. Do you know that the world is ripe for the youngsters to rule us? There are countries, yes, we have Costa Rica. Its president, Carlos Quesada, his age is 39, and the prime minister of Andorra, which is a small country between France and Spain, his prime minister, Zamora, he is aged 40. Bhutan's king, or nearby Bhutan, King Jigme Khesar Namangyel Wangchuk is only 39. And the emir of Qatar, Al Thani, he is 39. And we have the young lady, New Zealand Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern, she is only 39. And Finland is headed by a Prime Minister, Sandra Marin, he has aged 34. So the world is ripe for the youngsters to take control. I would like to say, if Mr. Goyal invites me for the Diamond Jubilee celebrations of the Republic of India, I would like to have a country led by a prime minister, states led by chief ministers who are less than 40, and 51% should be young women. India is ripe for that. Yes, India's destiny is shaped with the youngsters. As the Kothari Commission said, India's destiny is being shaped in her classrooms. I have no hesitation to say, India will live in her youngsters. India will lead. Indian youth will lead the world. As Arnold Toynbee said, that chapter which has a European beginning should have an Indian ending if this whole universe is not to be destroyed. And the world should be led by Indian values. That is what Arnold Toynbee wanted. India is ready. When I see the young faces, radiant faces, a million faces of youngsters in front of me, I can say, India is ready. India will rule the world. India will rule the world to righteousness. Satyam Vada, Dharmam Vada, Jai Bharat, Vande Mataram. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, our chief guest, who has given such a motivational, inspirational, informative, educational, and patriotic views, speech. I will not term it a speech. It was coming from his heart. And that is what. And what he has mentioned is very clear, that India is now a global leader. If you see any field, even although he has not mentioned, but I would like to add one thing. Even in the management of the COVID, you see all the world, the entire world, whether Europe or UK or USA, India is leading. The mortality rate is nothing in India. Yesterday was 120 or so, while in USA or UK, they are in few thousands. And their population is nothing in front of our population of 1.4 billion. So this is, that's the credit goes, which Dr. Bose very rightly said, the credit goes to the youngsters, the young scientists, the young doctors, engineers, everywhere, whether it is in the space. If you see the today, our space program, according to Dr. Bose, we are leading in that. We have Chandrayaan and Mangalyaan. We are also leading in the management of, in the medical side. We are also leading for every side, whichsoever field, like whether it is a green revolution, a white revolution, everywhere, although in a short span, it's not a big span of 72 years are there, but just imagine when the country was independent, how much funds or what resources we were having. And today, India is one of the pre-COVID, if you see, the fast growing country in the world, because of the determination, because of the hard work, because of the knowledge imparted by our educationists, the teachers, the professors, as well as the correct direction taken even by the politicians. We must give the credit to them. It's very easy to say against them, but we must give credit. Today, if India is leading, because of everyone and the youth, according to Dr. Bose, youth plays a very, very important role. And he has mentioned two very, very important things and two factors. And he says one is mother, other is youth. And he is very forthright to say very clearly that because of the mother, today our scientists, our doctors, our engineers are leading all over the world. And you can see, even you see all the top multinational companies are headed by Indians. After all, they are also son or daughter of a mother. And you all know very well that how, in what conditions our mothers have upbring the youth, those who are ruling today. And he said the second aspect is the youth. And the youth, according to Dr. Bose, our chief guest, he wants to see that youth become, be involved in the parliament, in the politics, and should become a prime minister in near future, because youth can take lead in many, many fields and successfully. Thank you very much, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, for giving such a motivational, inspirational talk of yours. I am sure everyone, all those who are participating here, all those who are viewing, even I will say, even the elders like me or the senior citizen like me, felt inspired by your motivation. And one more point which he has mentioned, I would not like to miss it. And that is, please take care of your elders, especially the mother. Don't send her to a old age home. She has taken care of you when you are young. Now it's your time to repay. And that's what the message by Dr. C.V. Anand Bose. Thank you very much, Dr. Bose, for giving such a inspirational, patriotic message on the 72nd Republic Day of India. Now I would like to invite our youth guest. And my first youth guest is Miss Aisha KM. Miss Aisha KM, please unmute yourself. Miss Aisha KM, are you hearing me? Yes. Miss Aisha KM, you have heard our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose. He has what he has spoken. Now we would like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Miss Aisha KM, please.
Good morning to all. I am Aisha KM from Kerala. I am doing my UG program on literature in Al-Azhar College of Arts and Science, Thodupura, Kerala. First of all, I would like to thank the respected authorities for giving me a chance to explore my views on the topic, the role of youth in the Republic. Youth is the most important segment of the population in any country. The developing countries with large youth population could see tremendous growth. They are very enthusiastic and energetic. Today, they might be our partners. Tomorrow, they will be our leaders. Our youth can bring social reform and improvement in the society. Their involvement is required for our country to attain success. Also, they can convince people who are fighting each other on the basis of religion, caste, language, etc. Also, our youth should be motivated to consider the politics as a mean to serve the nation. They should be involved in the movements against the malpractices such as corruption. Also, they should be empowered to raise their voice against all the illegal decisions and practices which perform in our country. It will all possible with a proper, better education. Nowadays, youths are becoming a depressed segment of our society. There are degrees but no jobs. There are PhDs but no profession. In India, the youths are not given a choice to select their interest of field. One must become an engineer or a doctor. If I didn't get an admission in science or commerce stream, I go on arts. That's what Indians feel. The students admit to a stream which have higher pay scale or higher number of job opportunities. But in foreign countries, students are allowed to choose their course according to their interest so that they can bring out their best for the country. For example, if my field of interest is law firm or journalism and I'm compelled to choose medical field, I won't be happy with my profession. I won't be happy, and that's a horrible thing. So let them choose as per their interest. Let them choose their career according to their wish. Then only it will become an asset for our country. As the education, the health is also important. In India, we provide many hospitals with world-class treatment, with good facilities, relatively lower cost. But also we have hospitals which are understaffed, insufficient facilities, no medicine, or may not be able to provide a bed or an ambulance for a patient. And also, there is a shortfall of 2 million doctors and 4 million nurses in 2015 because most of them went overseas for higher pay. So more funding, and this will also affect our country because youth are our asset, and if they work for foreign countries, it won't be productive for us. They should work for our country. And then the next thing is, they should go overseas, which will be productive for the foreigners too. Then we should more funding and high wages for this sector could solve this issue. The youths can change the society. They are the biggest power, and it is proved by many movements and incidents. A mass protest in Delhi for justice of Nirbhaya case, a mass protest for India against corruption, a mass protest for Jallikattu in Marina Beach are some of the prominent examples which proves the strength of the youth. It is important to resolve all the issues faced by the youth. Otherwise, they are compelled to choose more destructive path, and that will lead to the fall of our nation. Let me conclude that youth can make their land shine in success with peace. So do remind that they are tomorrow's innovators, creators, builders, and leaders. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Aisha. And you have mentioned one thing about the that one has to choose the subject. If you go through the new education, National Education Policy 2020, which was just released in the July last year, it is very clearly mentioned now, and the power has been given to the students and even to the universities and the colleges that you can choose whatsoever you want to do, multiple entry and multiple exit. As you said, that suppose you are not liking medical, you can choose to go for the arts or wherever. So the new education policy will be now the milestone for the youths, if they will take it properly. You have mentioned about those agitations. Protest and agitations are good, but it should not be. Try to avoid those things if you can apply your mind, and if you see it can be sorted out. So, but it is a good thing what you have raised today. I am sure that youths, if they just think in such a way, that the country is going to be very, very prosperous in future, because now we have a vibrant youths who can even think like this. But please go through this new education policy. You will find the 100% answers of your all questions which you have raised. Thank you very much, Ms. Aisha, for giving you such a good thoughts. Now I would like to go to my next youth guest, and she is Ms. Chinmay Rao. Ms. Chinmay, you have heard our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, and you have also heard our earlier youth guest. Now we would like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Ms. Chinmay Rao, please. First, you introduce yourself, and then please.
Okay. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, please.
Good morning to you all. I'm Chinmay. I'm an architect by profession, residing in Manipal. So today, before we knowing the role of youth in Republic India, we need to understand what is Republic. So Republic is something that is connecting to the people. It's a system in which the country belongs to the people, the government belongs to the people. Democracy is the greatest means of restoring this kind of system. Democracy is explained well as democracy is for the people, by the people, and of the people. We can proudly say that India is the largest democracy in the world. But by only saying this, the country cannot become republic. For that, it needs a constitution, which is made by many elected representatives. A constitution is the basics of representative determinants that determines the distribution and the use of supreme power. Our country is blessed with so many great personalities such as Swami Vivekananda, Sardar Vallabhai Patel, Bhagat Singh, Indira Gandhi, and many more. We are blessed to have their qualities under us. Swami Vivekananda has shown excellent exalted path, but it is so strange to see that we are not able to see that in any of the youth currently now. So, and once Dr. Abdul Kalam was asked, what is the strength and weakness of India? And the answer he gave was youth. There are 261 million youth in India, and that has become the strength of India. And the vision and right guidance has become the weakness. The nation dies without vision and right guidance. Vision is the only quality that is lacking in the present youth today. So we need to implant to work upon all the compatible qualities that already exist within us today. India is very prestigious. India is in very prestigious position in the world map today. So it's our duty to maintain the same and to take our country to a greater height. So we can all do that by working on those quality, which we will understand our responsibility towards our nation. So once we understand our responsibility to our nation, we start our respect to the nation will increase, towards our people will increase. We start to gain more and more respect to our nation. That day our nation will see a change. Today's celebration is a trust of deal within all those soldiers. I respect and salute all those soldiers who has sacrificed their life for the betterment of our nation. I salute all those freedom fighters who are still working in the borders, protecting us, protecting our nation to continue this freedom. And once again, thank you for this opportunity today.
Thank you very much, Ms. Chinmay Rao. And I'm sure what you have felt that yes, in India, we require youth to be guided properly. Yes. And that's why our endeavor is to keep such type of media conference at least twice a week so that you can join or you can hear or view and you will be guided. So it all depends on the youth, him or herself, where you, because today the youth is very enlightened. I am sure our chief guest will also agree. We were not that much enlightened. We were not that much technical savvy. We were not having all these things what you are having. You have internet, you have television, everything with you. We were not having all those things. Even the transistor was not there. It came afterwards. And at that junction, when you have everything, only thing is you must choose the right path. You can choose yourself. You can, if you are on the social media, see what is the positive aspect. Negativity is always there. To criticize anyone or to government is very easy. But what is the solution? What is the positive aspect? If you have any positive solution, positive aspect, try to give that positive solution and positive aspect. Everybody would like to follow you. But the views which you have raised are pertinent. Yes, why not? We must raise these views and then only we'll come to know what is the right thing. Thank you very much, Ms. Chinmay Rao, for giving your views. Now I would like to go to my next guest and youth guest, and she is Miss Monica Sharma. Miss Monica Sharma, please unmute yourself. You have heard our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, as well as earlier youth guest. Now we would like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Miss Monica Sharma, please.
First of all, a very good morning and Jai Shri Krishna to everyone. Respected chief guest, Mr. C.B. Anand Bose, chief editor, Mr. Lal Goyal, all the GAN mentors and all the participants of various institution and school. I, Monica Sharma from Gyandeep Siksha Bharati Senior Secondary School, Mathura, TGT Science. Firstly, I would like to wish a very happy Independence Day to everyone.
Republic Day.
Oh, sorry, sir. That's 72nd Republic Day. Okay. So, also, I'm very glad to you, sir, that you gave me an opportunity to speak on such a nice topic. So, I would like to start with this beautiful sentence, that is, Ye desh hai veer jawano ka. So in my opinion, the youth is the gentle push, the burden breakers, the change makers, and the angry voice. So all the adjectives fit the context perfectly when we talk about youth. Today, India is one of the youngest nation in the world because more than 62% of the total population of our India is in the working age group, means 15 years to 59 years. And more than 54% of the total population is below the age of 25 years. So the power of youth is the commonwealth of India. The young faces, people are the faces of our present, our future, and our past. So I believe that no segment in the society can match with the power, idealism, enthusiasm, and the courage of young people. So I believe that, in my opinion, the role of youth in Republic India, it simply means renew, refresh, and maintain. Because youth plays a great role in the nation. Because the youth has the power to develop a country and make the country towards the progress. And they are also responsible, the youth is also responsible for bringing social reformer within country. So I think the power of youth determine the future of the nation. So I can proudly say that our youth is serving by doing such type of great jobs, as many NGOs are coming up with the different and various volunteering projects with the aim of helping and awaring communities. Youth is also reaching to others by social media, through the social media. Even a small hashtag can go viral on Twitter and create awareness. Youth is also participating in online campaign. And the very important thing that youth is inspiring other young people by joining the different youth organization. So sir, at the end, I would like to say, हम लाए हैं तूफान से कश्ती निकाल के मेरे देश को रखना मेरे बच्चों संभाल के. थैंक यू सर. जय हिंद जय भारत.
थैंक यू वेरी मच मिस मोनिका शर्मा. एंड यू व्हाट यू हैव सेड इज राइट दैट यूथ कैन प्ले वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल फॉर द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द कंट्री एंड यूथ इज प्लेइंग नाउडेज. इट्स ए वेरी करेक्टली यू सेड अबाउट द सोशल मीडिया. यस देयर आर सो मेनी थिंग्स व्हिच आर कमिंग अप. And even if you see in the COVID vaccine, how our yes. Indian scientists, young scientists, people have done the research and they came out with their indigenous vaccine. While many countries in the world, so many countries, how many countries could develop? And today India is proud to export, to send those vaccines to so many countries. And I'm sure the youth can play a very, very important role in this vaccination program. By sending a proper, correct message on the social media. I appeal to all the youths, please don't go for a negative reports. Please read, study properly, and forward only those things which are proper. Because if we will save the life, it's as good as saving so many lives. One life is also important, and this youth can do. And youth have that power by using the social media correctly, which you said. Thank you very much, Ms. Monica Sharma, for giving your views. Now, I would like to invite my next youth guest, and she is Ms. Niranjana Ramchandran. Ms. Niranjana Ramchandran, please unmute yourself. And Ms. Niranjana Ramchandran, yes. You have heard our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose. You have heard earlier youth guest. Now, we would like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Ms. Niranjana Ramchandran, please.
One and all. First of all, let me wish you all a very happy Republic Day. I am Niranjana Ramachandran, a student of class 11 from Kulabadi Munshi Bhavan Vidya Mandir, Potur, Thrissur, Kerala. And first of all, I am humbled and honored to share this same platform with eminent personalities like Sri C.V. Ananta Bose sir and Lal Goyal sir and many other bright young students from different parts of the country. And let me express my views on the topic, the role of youth in Republic India. I would like to start quoting Amanda Gorman, American poet. Even as we grieved, we grew. Even as we hurt, we hoped. Even as we tired, we tried. There is always light, only if we are brave enough to see it. There is always light, only if we are brave enough to be it. Amanda Gorman. And I strongly believe that this light is our youngsters. This light which can guide us, this light which can take us to new heights is our youngsters. Youngsters are the most dynamic and energetic segment of any population. They are the change makers. They are the problem solvers. How old was Jesus Christ when he redefined the meaning of love? How old was Sri Buddha when he left his kingdom and his entire luxuries to find the true meaning of life and salvation? How old was Bhagat Singh when he sacrificed his life for our country? They were all youngsters and they were ready to give up their life for the pleasure, the happiness of many others. And this is why the youth is considered as the flag bearers of change, the new era of change. And our country, India, we must be proud because we are having the second largest youth population in the world, or the most largest youth population in the world. And I strongly believe that this is the most important resource that we possess in this period of time. If this large young population, if we are able to mold them, if we are able to educate them, empower them, they have the capacity and capability to transform our country from a developing country to a developed country. We saw how the world countries are thanking India for the vaccines which we are providing them. That is the effort. That is the, what you call, the effectiveness or the power of our youngsters to leave their families behind and to work day and night in the hospitals, in the labs, finding out the new vaccine, in protecting our population, in fact, the world itself from this pandemic. And today I would like to make a few points. The first one is that Republic Day, we once again remember that our strength is in our unity. We are not, India is not the same in two places. We are very much diverse. With every 1 kilometer, the climate, the dressing pattern, the food, everything changes in India. And that is our strength. Our strength is in our unity and our rich heritage. So the young people, if we want to lead India, or if we want India to be one of the most developed, full equipped and powerful countries in the world, we should understand that our strength is in our unity, in diversity. We must respect our culture and heritage and understand the culture and heritage of others. In the opening speech, our chief guest, C.V. Ananta Bose said that we must not abandon our mothers. That is not our culture. Our heritage and our culture teaches us that mother is God. Parents are God. Teachers are God. So we must understand our culture, respect our heritage and take it and inherit it to the future generation and in fact the world. And then another thing and another point which I would like to make is that we are all very much aware of our rights. We all teach our youngsters about our rights, but not about responsibilities. With rights come responsibilities. Our constitution provides us with an extensive set of rights and responsibilities. So while enjoying about rights, we must be aware of our responsibilities, our constitutional responsibilities, and we must impart them in our lives. Then India would be able to develop, or that is the correct balance. We must know our rights, we must exercise our rights, as well as we must impart and practice our fundamental duties. With fundamental rights comes fundamental duties. There should be a correct balance between our rights and responsibilities. So it is once again, we are celebrating the 72nd Republic Day. And the idea of republic, it's not new to our land. We had republics in our history. The clan of Sri Gautama Buddha, they were a republic. So this idea of republic, it's not new to our land. It's that we left it at some point of the history. So we youngsters, we are the future of our nation. We must be aware, we must be educated and well-versed in the constitutional principles of secularism, socialism, liberty, justice, equality. And we must lead our country forward. We are the second largest or the largest youth population in the world. The future of the world is in our hands. We must prove that Indian heritage and Indian culture is not second to anyone or anything. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Niranjana. And you have mentioned very clearly that Indian culture is not to abandon the parents or the mother especially, as well as they treat the God, the teachers, the parents, all as God. Yes, if this culture, that's what our chief guest, Dr. Bose, has mentioned, that if you are going to treat your elders, especially your mother, properly, then definitely the blessings and the good deeds which are going to come to you and to your next generation will be tremendous. And this is where the India is having that strength. And that's why we are leading in almost every sphere nowadays, because of this inherent strength. As Dr. C.V. Anand Bose also mentioned, our chief guest today, about the kitchen, the mother's kitchen. This, you all have seen that the mortality rate of this by this pandemic is far less in India than anywhere else. The reason is the homemade cooked food which was given to us by the mother, the wife, the sister, the daughters, the lady of the house. So all these things depends. So it all depends on you. How you treat the elders, you will also get the same way the return. Thank you very much, Ms. Niranjana, for giving your views. Now, I would like to invite my next youth guest, and she is Ms. Shalik G. Pinto. So you have heard what our chief guest has mentioned, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, as well as all other youth guests before you. So now we'd like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Ms. Shalik G. Pinto, please.
A very happy Republic Day and a very pleasant morning to everyone. I am Shalik Pinto and I'm currently pursuing bachelor's in social work in School of Social Work, Roshni Nilaya in Mangalore. I'm in my second year. I'm very grateful to the dignitaries who thought I was capable enough to talk on such an auspicious day. I hope that whatever I speak today is not just a normal Republic Day speech, which everyone forgets the next day, but rather be heard by someone who match with what I think and what contribution I want to make for this country. As a youth, what is my role in Republic India? Youth is a foundation for nation building because majority of India's population includes youth. Many youngsters join army, various voluntary groups, spread their opinions through social media, as it has a very vast networking and can create awareness in a very less time among mass population. But keeping all these major things in mind, let's not forget the other things that we can contribute for love and responsibility of our nation. Respecting everyone, irrespective of their gender, religion, race, caste, creed, or anything. As a youth, I want to be a person who thinks marriages aren't for dowry, where I don't lecture anyone on their sexual preference or their clothing. I want to be a youth who's not a threat to the country. I want to be a youth who doesn't judge people on their looks. I want to be in a country where everyone are treated equally, where everyone gets justice and where law is not misused. As not only youth, but as a human being, let's take an oath that we live and we let live. And remember that nothing can be achieved without humanity in this world. This Republic Day, let's all promise to ourselves that we give our best contribution to our country, to the citizens, as well as to the most important thing, to the environment of our country. Wherever we are in any corner of the world, let's not forget where our roots belong. I would conclude by quoting Dr. Ambedkar's beautiful words, which goes by, "We are Indians firstly and lastly. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pinto, for giving your views. And you rightly said that we should not forget that we belong to our this great country and we where our roots are. And you must be knowing now, by now, that during this COVID, lots of problems were faced by the migrants as well as Pravasis, those who were abroad, and they have to come back to India. And at that time, the government of India provided them many things which at least they could survive in that time. And for that only, the one-man expert commission for labor was constituted by the government of India, of which Dr. C.V. Anand Bose is the chairman. Already he has submitted one report, but two more reports it's under preparation, which he's going to submit soon. And in that report, if you go through the report, any one of you are interested, you will find so many good suggestions for the benefit of all those who are either Pravasis or who are working in a metro cities, and those who want to go back to their roots, or they have gone back and they want to come back to the again for the work. Everything has been taken care. So that's why if youth take the things positively, if they just study properly, if you just see what is happening, not only depending on the gossips or on the WhatsApp university, then the youth can play very, very constructive role for the Republic of India. Thank you very much, Ms. Pinto, for giving your views. Now I would like to move to the last panelist of ours, youth panelist, and she is Ms. Shavya K. Ms. Shavya, please unmute yourself. Yes, Ms. Shavya, you have heard our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, and you have also heard our earlier youth guest. Now we would like to know from you the role of youth in Republic India. Ms. Shravya K, please.
Yes, sir. So very good morning to all, and happy Republic Day. So myself is Shravya K, pursuing my MCOM in Mangalore University, Konaji. So as we all know, youth is the spring of our life, and it is the age of discovery and dreams. So India is a developing country, but with the populations, like you all know, it is one of the biggest population in the world. So of course, youths are very much more in number in India. So what I am saying is, like, we can be a developed country with such number of youths, because if we give proper education, then if we prevent their health and monitor them properly, then definitely we can be a developed country. So a youth is a person who is between the age of 15 to 30 years, and it is also known as, like, youth is a backbone of our nation. So this is because all other age groups, like kids or else a middle-aged person or senior citizens, they are too much dependent on youth, what I believe. So this makes the youth to be an important age group in both today's society and in the future society. Therefore, due to the high dependence on youth in the society, we the youth have a role to play, because the future of our families, communities, and our nation lies in our hands. So India is the largest population in the world. So the entire world is eyeing India as a source of technical manpower. They are looking at our youths as a talent, a source of talent, at low cost for their future super profits. So if we, the youth of India, make ourselves to work in India unitedly, then of course we can work here only, like, rather than going to abroad and working there, we can work here and we can serve our nation better. And also, as sir told, he want to see a politician, a young politician. Of course, if the youths are given enough of opportunities and chance, of course, they can be a politician. And of course, they can go for a higher positions, like prime minister, governor, chief minister, and ministers and all. So I think knowledge and unity, which makes a person more which makes a person more better than the experience. Experience is also required, but if the knowledge and unity is there, then of course anything can be achieved. And in India, there are many crimes taking place every day. We can read in the newspapers, anywhere we can see. But if youths are united and they protest against such kind of crimes, then definitely at least we can see the decrease in that crime, whatever the crime now we have. And yeah, religion is the main issue what we are facing in India. But still, if the youths are convincing their fellow men, then definitely this religion can also be driven from the India. And yeah, youths seems to have the ability to face any kind of problems, and they can also have a ability to solve the problem also. The role of youth is of most important in today's today's world, because it has underplayed itself in field of politics. They should become aspiring entrepreneurs rather than mere workers. So what I believe is like they have to become an entrepreneur than working in any other sector. So self-entrepreneur. It can play a vital role in utilization of elimination of terrorism. Young participation is important because youth are the country's power. The wise youths who are not given enough of opportunities should be taken into consideration. Some of them, too, they are educated and unemployed. They should be given an opportunity to explore their intelligence to the world and make themselves into someone. Some organizations and other firms should assist the youth so that they can make our land great and educated one. They will make a huge difference in society and in the entire world. The youths are life of our nation. They will make our country proud. The country will be recognized. The youth just need support from their fellow citizens, and they will perform their duties. So today's youth is full of spark. It burns every thing what it touches. They are not obstinate. They make mistakes and learn from it. They have the courage, which is inexplicable. They are dynamic. They have written their fate themselves. They have the key to the lock, and they are the only ones who can set the caged bird free. So finally, I would like to conclude with the beautiful message by our Honorable Prime Minister. He says that India is the world's most youthful nation. A nation with such youth power cannot dream small. We cannot commit this crime. We should dream big. We should enable the youth to dream big, and we should give them an opportunity to realize their dreams. Thank you. Thank you for giving me such opportunity.
Thank you very much, Ms. Shravya. And you have mentioned about the politics. Yes, you, as our chief guest, Dr. Bose, has mentioned that youth should come forward. But I would like to bring one fact again. I am bringing almost in all my youth's program. In the first parliament that was constituted in 1952, there were 26% of the MPs which were below 45 years of age. In the present parliament, only 12% MPs are below 45 years of age. So it all depends on youth. If you would like to participate in the policy making, you have to elect the youth leaders. You should have your own unity, unless you will not. After all, you are 65% population of India. So basically, majority rules as per the democracy principle. So when you have the power, you are the in majority, try to elect more, so that the dream of our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, as well as of all the youths of the country, can fulfill, then we can see that you on the higher posts are youth, somebody sitting on the high post. Thank you very much, Ms. Shravya, for giving your views. My question is one only to each of you, one by one. Okay. And you have a time of 1.5 to 2 minutes to speak. My first question goes, the same question will go to everyone. Ms. Aisha KM. Ms. Aisha, if you become the Prime Minister of India, what changes you would like to bring to the country, so that whatsoever you are dreaming or whatsoever the youth wants, what things you require, think that the country should change if you be given the power. Miss Aisha, please.
Sir, first of all, I will ensure that whether the law is practicing in India is same to our constitution, because now it violates sometimes. Laws are violated sometimes, and in case of politics and in case of health also the laws are violated. Even the traffic rules are also violated. So I will ensure it. And then the most or biggest huge issue we have seen is the problem of farmers. And I will try to bring my best for every sector, every people in every sector. There is no majority, minority or anything. People are all equal in front of law, and I will try to ensure equality among our country. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Aisha. Now my question goes to Ms. Chinmay Rao. If you will be given the power, the supreme power in India, and you will be asked to do which you are asking now, so if you will be given the power, what changes you would like to do so that the according to you, the youth's what youth wants, aspirations can be fulfilled, and the country will can develop more according to you. Ms. Chinmay, please.
I want the proper guidance to be given to all the youth so that they can select on what education they want to and on what way they can choose. So proper guidance and the vision has to be given is what I feel.
Okay.
We face a lot of problems because of we can't understand the other people's culture. We can get it. And this is the reason why we are having a little bit intolerance in our country. So if I get a chance, I will announce for a program that student exchange, where a student from Kerala can go and stay in a school in Rajasthan for almost like 2 months and understand the culture and heritage. Every student may not be able to travel the length and breadth of a country like India, which is very vast. Everyone will not have that economic stability. So if the government is propagating such an program, we can understand our country better. And almost everyone will get a chance to, you know, see our country.
I think that is a very good suggestion which you have given. I am sure our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, will definitely give a reply to you, as well as he, if it is not there in the because we have exchange programs which are from country to country. From India, the students are going abroad. But why not we have an exchange program within the country, so that from the Kerala or from Karnataka or from Tamil Nadu, it will go to the north through Jammu Kashmir or Haryana or UP, or and similarly vice versa. So that the culture, the things which are happening there, they will also understand. Very good suggestion. I am sure when our chief guest will speak, they will definitely, he will take a reply to you at this point. Now I would like to go to my next guest, and she is Miss Shalik G. Pinto. Miss Pinto, if you will be giving the supreme power, what changes you would like to, how you are going to impact something, or you are going to change something so that it will be beneficial for the youths or the country?
If I become any time, luckily, the Prime Minister of India, I feel the thing which I want to not force people to get things in their heart, that they should respect the law. In India, it's if we go to see abroad or something, people respect and they fear the law. But in India, maybe through corruption or maybe through superiority complex of some people, if they are rich or something, the law takes time, because you know we can't blame the government or we can't. But there are people who are under government, or maybe there are some people who have that thing like corruption or something. So I want to make sure that everyone respects the law, and the law is equal for everyone, irrespective of anything, of their gender. And even one thing that, you know, the equality, it's whenever now, the for my personal experience, when I went to one bank recently, I saw there were women working, but not as equal as men. So I want to make sure that in every sector that a woman should have an equal opportunity as a male person, that everyone should be equal in this country and the law should be feared or respected by everyone.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Pinto. Although opportunities are everywhere, there is no division or no partiality for men or women, especially in the services. It all depends on the talent and your how you are getting the marks or the your viva and your interview. You can be selected, but there is no such. But yes, this is a good point that everywhere. And but nowadays the women are coming. Recently, there is a news that a all women crew has flown from San Francisco to Bangalore and over the North Pole. Yeah. That is a very encouraging thing. I'm sure women will definitely come forward and dominate the country soon. Now, my last, not last, because one panelist we have left in between, Ms. Shevya K. If you are giving the full power, what you are going to do?
Okay, being a commerce student, always I'll think like that type only. So the economic trigger happen when a country has more hands to work than more mouths to feed. So if there is, I'll make sure that all youths will get a job.
Okay.
Employed, and all the laws and rules are followed in the country properly.
Okay.
And there. And there will be, you know, of course, in India, we have to respect each religion equally. We have to treat all religion equally, but at least we have to respect the other religion.
No, that you have to do it, not the Prime Minister. Prime Minister never yes. says that don't respect the religion
yes.
or whatsoever. But it all depends on us. It depends on the youth that they should respect and they should follow the laws. No one says that you should not follow the laws. Everyone wants that you should follow the laws. But if youth will start following, then definitely it will change. Now, I would like to go to Ms. Monica Sharma. Are you ready to reply, Ms. Monica Sharma? Are you there? Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Tell us if you are giving a supreme power.
So after thinking a lot, I think that reservation must be stopped. Because I think that... we have so many talents and so many means youth have so much talent, but I think reservation must be stopped. So if I would be a prime minister, I will definitely work on that.
Very nice answer. But Ms. Monica, the
yes,
one side you are saying the reservation should go. At the other side, the women want the reservation for women only everywhere.
No, sir.
So... Okay,
I am against it, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Now I would like to go to our chief guest. I'd like to request our chief guest, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, IAS. He has heard everything of yours, and now we want him to give his inspirational, motivational reply as well as his observations to all of us and to the viewers also. Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, please.
Thank you. Goel Saab, I was really delighted by the resonating confidence which came out of the discussions here by the youngsters. I have before me a set of youngsters, any of whom can lead this country as a prime minister. They have the clarity of vision and fix it your purpose. One thing which I noted among the youngsters here, who also represent the entire youngsters of India, they are the youngsters who would say confidently, I belong not to the East or the West or the North or the South. I belong to the whole of India, and the whole of India belongs to me. That is the message which I could gather from the youngsters who spoke here today. Now, my confidence in the new generation has really got a quantum jump now. About a new generation, there is a feeling that a new generation is always glued to their gadgets and they do not see what is happening outside. But that is not the case. The new generation sees everything. They make their own assessment. And once they take a decision, In one click, they can change the whole society. They can change the whole world. If anyone has got any doubt, ask our old friend Hosni Mubarak. What happened in the Jasmine Revolution? The youngsters, the new generation of Egypt, they took some decision and one click, you saw the bloodless revolution, which changed the face of Egypt. That is the potential which we have. I have seen with my own eyes, when the great floods came to Kerala, I belong to Kerala. You know, these youngsters who were considered to be ignorant or indifferent to society, they just came out, got in the car, got the other youngsters standing on the roadside. They hit off to the place where rescue operation was required. They saved people, nameless, faceless people all around, and proved to the whole world the new generation is ready. I think the same feeling I get when I listen to these youngsters here. Yes, India's destiny is certainly safe to the new generation. But there are certain things which you elders also have to do. See, look at the touch of pluralism, which was very much there in the sincere words of these youngsters. See, India is secular, not because the word secular is there in the constitution. India is secular because we have a secular mind. And that secular mind is reflected in the youngsters. And bold statements. They want the rule. They want rule of law. They do not want a soft state where rules are meant for certain people and rules are amended for certain people or rules keep quiet for certain other people. No. The youngsters say India cannot be a soft state. India has to ensure that every man is equal before law. I think there's a sense of purpose among these youngsters. That is what gives me the hope that India is going to lead. India will certainly lead, there is no doubt about that. And one more thing, maybe oft repeated in some fora, but the example of the crocodiles on the Nile, you know, in the Nile, when it is dry, the animals come to drink water. There first comes a zebra. There are crocodiles in the Nile. The crocodile slowly comes, catches by the zebra, by the leg, pulls it down, and that is the end of the zebra. Then comes the rhinoceros. The crocodile slowly goes behind it, underneath its belly, gives it a big bite, turns its somersault, and the rhino is also finished. Then comes a lioness with her two cubs. The lioness comes majestically. The lioness takes rest on the banks of the river. The two young cubs are playing on the belly of their mother. One crocodile sees this. Slowly it comes forward. It eyes one of the lion cubs. The lioness knew something is amiss. The lioness just lifts her head. The crocodile is in doubt whether to go forward or backwards. The lioness just turns its head toward the crocodile. The crocodile runs for its life. The lioness does not do anything. The lioness only took out her inner strength, which was demonstrable to the others. The youngsters of India, take out your inner strength. You are second to none. I could see that confidence oozing out of the words of these younger people. I think it is this confidence which is going to save this country. I would also, by way of conclusion, remind you about the tribals of Amazon. You know, when an adolescent becomes a youth, there is a test. One test was, the youth is tied to a tree in the jungle. The jungle is infested by predators. Lions are there, tigers, leopards, bear, all kinds of predators are there. And this young man is tied to a tree. He has remained there all night. When he here heard the terrifying sound of these animals, he thought, how could my clanish leaders, how could the tribal leaders leave me here alone? And then, like Jesus Christ once said on the cross, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Jesus is saying, oh my God, oh my Father, have you also forsaken me? before Jesus comes back. Similarly, the young boy also feels, oh my dad, have you permitted this? That is tying me alone in a tree amidst the ferocious animals. The day breaks, he is untied from the tree. The youth sees just near him throughout the night, his father was standing guard with a raised up axe, and behind him, the tribal leaders were there with drawn up swords. Youngsters, you never feel you are tied up to a tree. We are all with you. We are in the evening of our life. Your government, your people, the civil society, the elders, we are all with you. Bharat Mata is with you. You are not alone. We will not leave you alone. You are going to be the conquerors. Yes, the intellectual conquerors of the world, because you will be able to spread the culture and heritage of India to the world. And the culture of heritage of India believes in Vasudhaiva Kudumbakam. Yes, the whole world is one family. Which other culture is there that can teach this? That is why Arnold Toynbee rightly said, the chapter which had a European beginning should have an Indian ending. I am sure if this is the words of the youth of this country, well, the entire world is going to be enlightened, like Gautam Buddha under the Bodhi tree. When these youngsters come, that will lead to the enlightenment of the whole world. Thank you so much. Wish you the very best.
Thank you very much, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, for giving again once more the very motivational, inspirational talk. And I'm sure all our youths who are participating today have been enlightened, and those who are viewing our program are also been enlightened. And that's what, as per the Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, the entire country, the civil society, a government, everyone is with the youth. Please come forward, but be in a positive way, and which you are, which you have shown today. And I'm sure that if you all will take up the lead, the day is not far, and that the government, that we can proudly say that India is the global leader in the world. Thank you very much, all of you. And today's program has been live telecasted by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, Malnadu TV, News Gaonse, Samvad Sarokar News, as well as it was shown live on Facebook and YouTube. And our endeavor is to every day bring a new topic. And tomorrow, again, a topic, very relevant topic, current topic, and that is media conference with Lal Goyal. Will Biden, Kamala favor Indian policies? As you all know, that there is a change in the American presidentship and the vice presidentship, and the new team which has come is of Mr. Biden and Ms. Kamala Harris. And will Biden, Kamala favor Indian policies? And our panelists are Mr. P. Michael Veta Shiromani, IAS, former Vice Chancellor Rajiv Gandhi, National Institute of Youth Development, and former Additional Chief Secretary, Government of Kerala, Dr. P.K. Abraham, former Managing Editor and Managing Director, Rashtriya Deepika Limited, Kottayam, Professor Dr. Sudhir Charan, former Visiting Professor, IIM Lucknow and University of Texas, Dallas, USA, Mr. Arun Lakshman, Director, Center for Policy and Development Studies, former officer on special duty, Minister of State for Law and Justice, Trivendram, and Mr. Rakesh Kumar Jha, Civil Service Coach, Managing Director, Discourse Academy, Delhi. So please tune in tomorrow for media conference with Lal Goyal at 10:30 a.m. Thank you very much, Dr. C.V. Anand Bose, IAS, for giving such a good, inspirational and motivational talk today. And thank you all the youth guests who have joined. It's a very, very enlightened and very lively program today. And once again, very, very happy Republic Day to all of you, as well as all the viewers on this auspicious 72nd Republic Day of our great country, India. Thank you very much.